Welcome to another edition of Something Came From Baltimore. My name is Tom Gowker, and again, we have another special interview with an amazing soul singer, Ricky Fante. Audience, and go back in time to 2004 and listen to this song.
It's been such a long time since I kissed your face.
The song that you're listening to is It Ain't Easy, and the singer is Ricky Fante. This was the lead-off single from the Wonderful Virgin record debut, Rewind. Ricky Fante was signed to an artist development deal and a full backing from the Virgin label. And the results were outstanding. If you go to Amazon.com right now, you can read the 30 album reviews of Rewind. The album was scored 4 out of 5, so I'm not the only one that really likes this record. The reviews are passionate. Some are saying that the album could have dug deeper into the Stax tradition, while others saying that it was a little too retro for their taste. They've been having this passionate discussion in their reviews, but the one thing that they can agree on, that is Ricky Fante, that has the special voice that conjures up the kindred spirits of Wilson Pickett, Sam Cooke, Al Green, and Otis Redding. And while Ricky has the music gods inside of him, we are ready for Rewind Part 2. But fans would have to wait for another 12 years when the album Good Fortune was released. On Good Fortune, recorded with his music partner, Scott Rickett, it reveals another layer of Ricky's musical personality. Raised on hip-hop like De La Soul and Tribe Called Quest and rock music, Ricky's true vibe is more like Ben Harper, Lenny Kravitz, and Michael Fronte. He's a soulful roots rocker. In this episode, we chat with Ricky Fante and chat about his 2004 Rewind recording. He explains the music gap, review tracks from 2016 recording, and he is currently on stage portraying Otis Redding in Soul, the Stax Musical. The musical celebrates the Stax label and the stable of artists that create the Stax sound. Ladies and gentlemen, let's listen to another Ricky Fante song called Shine from the 2005 animated feature called Robots. Thank you, Ricky Fante, for visiting me at Something Came From Baltimore.
Thank you. Thank you for having me.
You were 24 years old when Rewind came out. You were a young guy, but you were linked to Sam Cooke and Wilson Pickett, Al Green, and even Otis Redding. Were you even listening to those type of artists at the time?
Not necessarily. So maybe every now and then Sam Cooke, but for the most part, I was probably listening to some form of hip-hop, Tribe Called Quest, De La Soul, you know, things of nature.
The good stuff. Yeah, I just feel that, you know, when you're a young guy, it takes time, I guess, to absorb these kind of artists and kind of see where they're coming from. But being young and having that voice, it feels like maybe you were delegated to that type of music when maybe that might not be your style.
A little bit of that. Yeah, there's truth in that, yes.
Were you happy with the recording of Rewind?
Rewind to me was a love-hate relationship. I didn't have the type of control, but I also, at this, you know, that I would have preferred to have in terms of song selection and even, for that matter, the video for It Ain't Easy. I didn't want that type of video. I didn't see the need to have a bunch of women in the background. I wanted more to, you know, let the video say what the songs, the lyrics said. So I felt like, you know, I woke up by myself in the middle of the night. I should have, you know, should have been shot like that. It should have been on the street. Who's the man on the corner with an empty cup? And I think that was more, you know, the marketing. Okay, this guy is blah, blah, blah. You know, he's going to be this type. And, you know, it's a live and learn. You know, it's you when you first come out the gate, you very rare that you do have that type of control. And to be fair, I didn't have the knowledge. So it was, you know, so that's where it's, I say it's a love and hate
As a fan of that album, I think your voice is fantastic. And I like what they attempted to do with you. And it wasn't until I listened to your new album that I was like, he is more of a like a Lenny Kravitz-y kind of guy. He is more of a Ben Harper-y kind of guy. And your voice is so distinct that I remember that time period. We're talking about 2004. Your album was kind of a rarity. It was you and Van Hunt that came out as new artists that they were really grooming. And I remember I used to work at Live of the World Cafe, and you were an artist for the month. They were playing your album very hard. I do love it, I have to admit. I think it's a fantastic album. But I don't feel, now that I've done a little research, that it was you. It was something, it's not officially you. I guess it has elements of you, but it's not your thing.
Well, and you're correct, especially if you listen to Good Fortune, you know, and you're right. It's so funny, like songs like on my new album, latest album, I should say, Good Fortune, I Think I Love Her, that's me. That's more me, more... You know, I try to stay soulful. I can't help but to be soulful, I guess. But, you know, I appreciate rock, you know, rock and roll with my writing partner, Scott Rickett. And, you know, I like ballads. I appreciate a good ballad, but I have to feel it, you know, in order to write it. And so if I'm working on a particular project, if I feel a certain way, it's, you know, I think it's important to stay true. And then you'll hear it, you know, because if I'm forced or kind of like directed to do something, then you can also hear that too. It may not come across as genuine as it should.
That album, Rewind, was just an anomaly at the time. There wasn't a throwback artist like that. As of now, there are throwback artists like Sharon Jones and St. Paul and the Broken Bones. And I think the climate would be more suitable now for that album to come out than it would be back then. It just seemed like it just didn't have a place to go. And I think that now we're, you know, a lot of people are not reaching to the radio. They're looking for playlists or where they like their music. And you would fit really well with that album in certain playlists. And I think you would find a following a little more. Where did you go after that? So we did Rewind, and you did a song called Shine from the movie Robots, which is a great song, and I never saw the movie, I honestly have to say.
Yeah, well, it's understandable. It was a cartoon. Yeah. I get that. But, well, I did Shine in 2005. I started working on movie projects, and then the person that was my A&R pretty much got fired at Virgin Records. And then the industry just really changed. And, you know, at the time I had young kids and I just wanted to just kind of focus on that. So I took advantage of things that I just thought weren't happening. And I felt like I can go back to school, finish school, because I kept going off and on. And I just wanted to be honest with you, take a chill pill. If the right deal, things didn't make sense, why try to force it? I would do things, you know, I would go to Italy a lot. That's where my album did really, really, really big. So I spent a lot of time in Italy, and I wasn't really pursuing. I would do things every now and then, like I did the Shark Tank original theme song, which was Money, and worked on several like indie projects with different people. Acting, I went back to study theater, took some classes, and didn't really force the issue. Meanwhile, still recording. And so that's during this time period, I would say anywhere from 2008 to 2016, I started recording, you know, with my writing partner, Scott, out in Huntington Beach, California. And we just, that's what you get when you get Good Fortune. You know, it's pretty much that time period.
Those years. Do you have regrets? Or from your experience in the music industry?
No. And I know, because I mean, it's given me an opportunity to, you know, go around the world, and, you know, I've done Jay Leno, Good Morning America, Soul Train, and Ellen DeGeneres, all these great things. I have no regrets. It's all, you know, even if I didn't beat Usher, his album Confessions. You know, I can't, you know, I can't be mad at that. I've been blessed to do a lot of things, and I'm still here, and I'm still able, you know, I'm currently on stage, you know, and playing Otis Redding. So I have no regrets.
I think so many people want Rewind 2. That was such a brand stamp that it would be hard for people to accept you kind of in anything else, because that was like a big deal for them. Do you find that?
Yeah, there was a lot of push. You know, there was a lot of marketing. I mean, nowadays, you think about the way I was marketed, you just don't see it like that anymore. If you think about it, it was one of the last record deals where you actually have a major record deal, a major team, marketing push, campaign, I almost said corporation, but I guess, yeah, corporate campaign push. Mm-hmm. And you just don't, it doesn't exist like that now.
Not at all.
I think Virgin Records, what's that?
Not at all. That doesn't exist at all. They don't.
No. I mean, some people make an argument that the record industry doesn't exist, you know, but I don't think it's that extreme, but it's definitely not like my experience and, mm-hmm. and the kind of push that I have. And, you know, it's funny because of the way that the record industry has changed. There are people, you know, that, you know, they're like, oh, wow, your music now, I've just playing it. And, you know, someone may call me and say, hey, man, I'm in the store and your music's on. And so after I kind of felt like when I was the only one doing it, being that vintage, like you had D'Angelo's of the world, but they were more like a Curtis Mayfield. Me, I went a little gritty and in a really, really, really vintage way. So I kind of liked it because, you know, it did show that I had some vocal chops and that I could do it. But I just didn't have the power, the artistic power to paint the picture the way I wanted to. And that happens. I'm not the first. I'm going to be the last.
Sure. I mean, now that you're just a little older than 2004, when you look back at these vintage artists like Sam Cooke, can we go through each artist and just get your feedback on them? Did you ever go back and say I'm studying these artists a little more? And like if I brought up Sam Cooke to you, what's your thought process? Have you studied him enough, or you just kind of walked away from them?
No. Goodness, no, I love Sam Cooke. You know, he's, and that's the blueprint for what I do. I still prefer that style of music. It's just, I have a lot more life in me now. I could probably, I'll sing a certain note with a little more pepper to it now, you know, and more emotional pepper, life pepper, you know, I'm more seasoned. Mm-hmm. And so when you say Sam Cooke, I think style-wise, I would say he is smooth, clean, sharp, precise, organized, vocally organized.
You know, and timeless, like Sam Cooke and Al Green, which you're compared to, their music is unique and it's as fresh today as it was when it was recorded.
Yes, I agree.
But there's one artist out of the group, and I know that you're doing Otis Redding, that you're on stage doing him right now, but I feel you're more kin to Wilson Pickett.
Mm-hmm. I've heard that, yeah.
Yeah. There is a growl to you that you just can't make up. I mean, it's just there.
Yes. Wilson Pickett.
Yeah. Stax Music, it's very broad topic, and there's so many different artists. You could basically do a whole play on, say, Sam Cooke or Wilson Pickett or Otis Redding. So it's interesting to put a whole, you know, Sam and Dave and Otis Redding, and you put them all together to create a storyline. Did they even ask you to audition, or they just say, you're playing Otis Redding?
Well, I did an audition actually at maybe 3 years, 4 years ago. I think it was closer to 3 years ago, some producers reached out to me, and I'd known someone. Someone knew me. It was actually Tasha Taylor, Johnny Taylor's, the soul singer Johnny Taylor's daughter, asked if I could, would I be interested in doing a reading for the workshop. And so did that. It was successful. And fast forward 3 years later, you know, I hadn't even thought about it, but, you know, they were still trying to make this thing happen. So I guess they had to go through whatever process that is. And fast forward to like maybe 5 months ago, they reached out to me and asked if I would still be interested in the character, doing the character. And I was literally riding my horse. And, you know, I was like, of course. And then they asked if I can send a video in of me portraying Otis Redding. Mm-hmm. And I didn't have a problem doing that. You know, it wasn't just the producers that I needed. You know, now when you're in this level, it's a team of players. And, you know, you have the actual casting company. They want to see, you know, the center stage. You know, it's not just the producers. And I understood that and I respected that. And so I think the call came in on Thursday. Saturday, I shot the video. And they wanted it Tuesday morning, and I got it to them Sunday night.
Do you remember the song that you played?
I did Sitting on the Dock of the Bay.
Okay. I'm sure it was awesome.
Oh, I thought it was good. It was good enough to get me here.
Yeah, it worked. Okay. Right, so Otis Redding, to me, is a workhorse. I mean, obviously, he left our world too early, but he was really, if you get his box set, he was just really working hard at, you know, creating memorable music. But I don't know anything about his personal life. Did you have to go in and kind of dig into his background to really develop the character, or were you really focused on his performances?
I would say 60% performance, 40% character, and try to put that together, obviously. There's not a lot of footage, you know, just with him talking, getting his talking voice down. So you just kind of have to read all the different bios and you come up with your own sense of who he was as a person. One interesting thing, the last time I was in Italy, I did a song with Carla Thomas. Mm-hmm. And we had a chance to talk and she told me a lot about Otis Redding. And so, you know, between talking to her and my research, I tried to, you know, kind of, I don't want to tell you how I play him, but, you know, I knew that he worked hard and he was touring and, you know, even in bad weather, you know, he wanted to push the envelope, you know? Mm-hmm. And one of the quotes that he used to say was, I got to make that money, you know? Yeah. And so from what I gather, he was a workaholic, you know, and that's, then I just take it from there. You know, I just, you know, there are the video footage of his performances. So I, you know, kind of look at all that and throw it in one pot of gumbo and give it my spin.
Let's talk about your good fortune. The album came out in 2016. You've been friends with Scott Rickett for forever because you guys recorded even before Rewind.
Yes, I've known Scott for quite some time.
Yeah.
Probably since 2000 or 1999, yeah.
Now, who does your President Obama impression on the album? Intros the whole album.
Oh. That's me.
Is it really? I believed it until the end, and then it just kind of fell apart. I just was like, okay, I don't believe that's him. I was like, because I thought you were living in D.C., and I thought maybe ran into him and was able to get him to do this.
Yeah, I had this, you know, that's me being, I guess, an artist. I've always been, like I said, I've been a fan of De La Soul, especially the first album.
Yeah, it's great.
And one thing they used to do was they would do these comedy skits in between songs. So I always remember, you know, listening to that as a teenager, like, oh, man. If I ever get a chance, I would do that. And so that kind of comes from that.
Good afternoon. I'm Barack Obama, President of the United States. I got a couple of things. Talk to you.
And then, if you know me personally, you know, people tell you, you know, I'm kind of goofy. I have a sense of humor. I, you know, at least I think I do. But, you know.
Oh, yeah. I'm trying to tell a joke. It was, I actually believed it up until the end, and then I was like, okay, that's not real. So you had me fool for a second. I have four songs actually I listened to and I really enjoyed. And what I now hear is that you're more on the Ben Harper side, the more Lenny Kravitz side, more melodic and kind of a rock vibe. I can actually see you headlining a jam band of some sort in the future. It just, I don't know. This is my vision thing for you. But the first song that I hear is Good Fortune.
Yes.
Good Fortune. You remember the thoughts about creating that song and how that came about?
Well, I had left Los Angeles and I just wanted to be around clean people, clean air, and I was living in Riverside, where I still live, specifically Moreno Valley, and a beautiful home up way up in the hills. I was staying with a good friend of mine, and I got a chance just to have clean air and just be in the middle of trees. And you know, this area is not as fast as LA, it's slow. And then I just started, you know, to have a sense of, you know, good fortune's coming my way, you know, just don't like, you know, don't be that artist, don't be angry, just believe, just keep focused, you know, just keep at my craft, jog, keep running, and things will come. Mm-hmm. You know, I don't believe that you just sit and wait. You know, if you can't change things on your own, what you can do is you can change yourself from within. And when that opportunity comes, because it does come, to be ready. You know, because like the song says, good fortune is coming my way.
How can I go on? Once upon a time was all I felt. Now that you've been gone, my life has changed in so many ways, yeah. Flashy cars, movie stars, think I buy a house on Mars. Good fortune coming my way, yeah.
The next song off the album is I Think I Love Her.
Mm-hmm.
Do you remember writing that song, what that was all about?
You know, it was that's one of every now and then you can do a song and you hear everything at once. And that's one of those songs. I'm not sure if I was thinking of anyone in particular, but you know, it's a song that, it just all came at once. The lyrics came, I think I was messing around on the guitar, hit a couple of chords, and I was just thinking about the way one would feel if, you know, you were trying to fight back loving someone or going there, you know, and it just kind of flowed, you know. It's one of my favorite songs. It's interesting that you mentioned it, but I think I love her. I always kind of vision myself being like on a street in LA, in a really fancy sports car at night, and kind of going fast, you know, with the street lights passing, whatever, that type of imagery.
I've been looking in your eyes, but then it's hard to lie. The things you say have taken toll on me. Cause if I haven't got a dime, you won't be far behind. I'm not saying, I'm just saying, baby. Since my best ain't good enough, people try to keep up. I can't explain this heart that's been on me. The moment I
can kiss it on your face. You kiss me back and set my spirit free.
Do you get that often where a song kind of just appears to you like that?
No, it doesn't happen too often, but when it does, I try to write as much as I can and do whatever I can do musically, and just get it down. And that was definitely that song. I knew where I wanted to go, you know, in terms of an intro, in terms of the body of the song, the bridge, the outro, it all just came. Yeah. So that doesn't, to answer your question, it doesn't happen too often.
Another song off the album that I really enjoyed was Get You Out of My Life. What was all that about?
That was funny. Now I think I was living that one. I was seeing someone at the time, and it just wasn't a healthy relationship on so many levels. And it was like, it was written on the wall, you know, I got to get you out of my life, you know. It's just, it's not good. It's not healthy. It's not good for me. It's not good for us. It's not good for you. So that song is definitely a true to the ear type of song.
I think a lot of people can relate to that. We're going to take a listen to that one also.
I just want to love you, girl. Lord knows I'm trying. But it don't seem like you want to. All you do is spend my money and waste gas in my car. You say you see the picture, but I don't see very far. Now I'm sinking down.
Another one that really got my attention is Fall from Grace.
Yes, that's interesting as well that you picked that song. That's probably more of what I was going through in terms of the record industry, you know, everyone telling you in your ear how good you are and you're the next best thing since McDonald's Big Mac burgers. And it, but you know, anyone could fall from grace. Like I say in the lyric, had I known that anyone could fall from grace. And then me coming up in church, that was kind of my give back, if you will, not so much a gospel song in the traditional sense, but it's my shout out to my faith and what I believe in.
No one can be praised. No better place. My Lord says, if you believe in me, I'll be by your side.
I be honest with you, I think that is my favorite song off the album.
Thank you.
Yeah, I listened to it all. We said it a couple of times. It's interesting to hear this album and hear the levels and the texture in your voice, and it does sound like you're enjoying yourself, and it sounds more intimate than your previous album, Rewind. I enjoyed Rewind, but I'm really enjoying this album also. I think it's kind of cool.
Thank you.
So thank you. Right now you're with Soul, the Stax Music. It's running in Baltimore up until June 10th. And then what's next for you after that?
Well, I plan on going back to Italy to do a couple of engagements. But, you know, I don't know. It's really kind of hard to plan because there's a whisper that this Soul Stax Musical may kind of take off and do its own thing. So I'm not sure. And for that matter, I'm not sure if they would even still keep me. You know, I've learned never to assume anything in this business. For me, you know, just return back to California, you know, be with the family, do the family thing, and just appreciate every day.
Now,
Yeah. You're ready.
Yeah, be ready for the next one. How can people get a hold of you?
Well, you know, it's funny. I don't do Twitter and Instagram. I figure Facebook is enough for me. I don't tweet Instagram. I like being somewhat, what's the word? Kind of just to myself in my own world, which is, you know, you can't really do that completely with the business that I do. My wife is my manager, my agent. I call her the wifinger. If someone is trying to reach out, you know, through Facebook or whatever, if someone knows me, whatever, they, you know, people, if they want to get to you nowadays, they can get to you.
That's right. That's how I got a hold of you, right through Facebook.
Yes, exactly.
This has been a joy for me. I have played your album for years, wondering what would happen, and it's so exciting to finally talk to you. I will be in a front row on Friday, and I can't wait to see you perform. I've been a fan for a really long time. It's an honor to speak with you.
Thank you, and that's mutual. I appreciate you taking the time to dig out some truths.
Ricky Fante, thank you so much for joining me on Something Came From Baltimore today.
Thank you.
We did it. That was awesome.
Thank you for listening to another episode of Something Came From Baltimore. I'm your host, Tom Galker. Please take the time to subscribe to your YouTube channel and podcast. Like the show, forward the show, and make comments. We are growing, and we want you to be a part of it all. Something came from Baltimore.